to know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India.
One of the most popular genres in entertainment is that of crime stories. Not just crime fiction, but even real life incidents come to rivet and titillate us. Today, we are going to talk about a book that deals with one of the most sensational crimes of pre-independence India, the Bawla murder case of 1925. We speak with author Dhaval Kulkarni, who's a journalist and has written this book called The Bawla Murder Case, Love, Lust and Crime in Colonial India. Thank you, Dhaval. Thank you so much for speaking with us.
My pleasure.
So, Dhaval, before I get to this sensational murder case, I wanted to get your perspectives as a journalist. Why do you think that these crime stories and these murder stories are so popular in India today?
Well, I think crime as a genre and as an happening or an event has this ability to sort of titillate people, to get them interested. So that is why be it some work of fiction based around a crime or even non-fiction or even some murders, etc. that happen in, today. So they have the ability to attract the attention of people.
To give our audiences a context, I mean, what was this murder case? If you could just briefly take them through, what was this murder case that happened in 1925, which some also call the Malabar Hill murder and by many other names?
See, on the 12th of January 1925, I mean, Abdul Qadir Bawla, at that point of time, was counted as one of the richest men in Mumbai. He went on a drive with his mistress Mumtaz Begum. Bawla was just 25 years old, and I'm very sure that many of your viewers who stay in Mumbai may at some point of time heard about a man called Haji Sabu Siddiq, after whom some institutions in the city are named. So he was Sabu Siddiq's maternal grandson. He was a Congress corporator in the PNC. He was elected from Mandvi in South Mumbai. So he and Mumtaz Begum went on a drive. They were accompanied by his driver, his cleaner, and also the manager of his estate. So when they were on Malabar Hill, I mean somewhere between Hanging Gardens and the Ridge Road, which is referred to as the BG Care Mark today, there was a car that overtook them from the rear. The car rammed into them first. They overturned and cut them off. Then 7 or 8 men got down. They abused Bawla, asked him to hand over Mumtaz Begum to him. Bawla obviously refused. They shot at Bawla. In fact, Bawla's manager, a man called Matthews, was also shot at in his arm, and the wound was so deep that eventually his hand had to be amputated. They shot at Bawla. They tried to abduct Mumtaz Begum. While doing so, they also tried to disfigure her face. In fact, her nose was almost severed from her face. So there was a series of coincidences that played out that day, and these coincidences would eventually change the course of history. So 4 British Army officers who had gone to play a game of golf at Billingdon Club opposite the racecourse at Mahalakshmi. So they were driving to Hotel Taj at Kulaba. So instead of taking the straight road from UG's road to go to the intended destination, they accidentally turned right and went up Malabar Hill, and they saw this whole fight being sort of this whole attack play out for them. Now these men were unarmed. I mean, these 4 army officers were unarmed. They were in civil dress. They just had 1 golf club with them, which they used in this whole because they rescued Mumtaz Begum. And while doing so, they used the only weapon available to them was this golf club, which broke in the middle. So you have it was a complete Hindi film style Marabari. This flight, the Lieutenant Sagar, who played a prime role in rescuing Mumtaz. So he was shot at 4 times, and of which 3 bullets hit him. He was slashed at with a kukri. He was stabbed, etc. But he managed to rescue Mumtaz. So then Bawla was taken to the JJ hospital, where he passed away soon after. And we are talking of 1925. when average salaries were around 100, 150 rupees, etc. At that point of time, Bawla had a fortune of 40 lakh. And in his dying declaration, he built 1 lakh to Mumtaz Begum. While these British army officers did something very significant, they captured one of the assailants. But they managed to capture one man who was later identified as Shafi Ahmad, who was working as a risaldar in the Indore State Mounted Police. Eventually, this case led to the abdication of Maharaja Tukojira Holkar of Indore. And the Holkars, as you know, were among the leading Indian princes. So this case led to a massive churn in society. There was a huge media trial, etc. There were three men who were sentenced to death in this case, of which only two could be hung, because the third man was a youngster aged around 22 or 23 years. So he went mad in jail. So since a lunatic cannot be executed, his sentence was commuted to that of life.
Fascinating. So, you know, there are many other, crimes, and also, is there any specific thing about this case that you know, you find it the most interesting? Is it like, you know, I mean, it seems so filmy, because there is this beautiful courtesan with two powerful lovers, one Muslim industrialist and a Hindu Maharaja, like a love triangle. And I find the character of this Mumtaz Begum Bawlewali, as she was later called, popularly called, very interesting. So can you just throw some light on her character, this central character of this drama?
See, Mumtaz Begum's grandmother was said to be in Maharaja Ranjit Singh's harem. Of course, later there was a legal dispute between Mumtaz Begum and her parents. I mean, she had a stepfather and also a grandmother, in which she disputed this. She said Maharaja Ranjit Singh had passed away long ago, and there was no way in which her grandmother could have been in his harem. So she came from a family of Punjabi Muslim courtesans, and when she was a teenager, she was inducted into Maharaja Tukojira Holkar's harem. In court, Mumtaz Begum claimed that her child was born to her from Maharaja Tukojira, and the nurses at Indore killed that girl. So, which is when she decided to flee the Maharaja's protection. She was not getting an opportunity to do so. When she was asked to go to Mussoorie from a place called Bhanpura, where Maharaja had taken her for the shikar. So she got down at Delhi, fled to Amritsar, where she was pursued by some of the Maharaja's men, and from there she came to Mumbai. Here, you know, the family was running short of money, so she decided to perform, because she came from a family of courtesans. And which is when she got in touch with Bawla and started living as his kept mistress. After this whole murder case, etc., after this whole controversy, she married a rich, the son of a rich trader from Karachi. They separated after 2 years or so. There was a movie that was made on her in Bollywood that was called Kulin Kanta. It was a silent movie. Later, Mumtaz Begum went to Bollywood, and subsequently we don't know what happened to her, but that, I mean, the last sort of authentic record that we get is Mumtaz Begum moving to Bollywood.
So this crime happens in Bombay, but how did they trace it to the Indore Darbar? Because it was to be, I mean, he was like one of the most powerful Maharaja Tukojira Holkar, whom, you know, people claimed was behind this whole thing, was one of the most powerful men, one of the leader of the leading princely states, the ruler. So how did they trace it to Indore and trace it to the Maharaja?
See, actually, they were caught with a smoking gun, in the sense that Shafi Ahmad, who was one of the attackers, was nabbed by the British army officers. He was in the custody of the Bombay police, as they were then known. And, some 3 days after the attack, there was a visitor who came to the office of the Bombay Chronicle, which was a very powerful English newspaper in those days. So that visitor claimed he knew this man Shafi Ahmad. So the newspaper contacted Sir Patrick Kelly, who was legendary police commissioners of Bombay. So an identification parade was arranged in which he identified Shafi Ahmad as a resolver from the Indo State police. Of course, the police already knew about Murtaz Begum's history with Indore because it had so happened that in 1919, Murtaz Begum and her mother Wazir Begum, who also present, had come to Mumbai with the Maharaja. And in his very seminal book on this case, Rohidas Dusar, the police officer whom I referred to earlier, he writes that one day Tukoji Rao visited Wazir Begum, Mumtaz, in Mumbai, and he offered to marry Mumtaz after getting her converted to Hinduism. So this offer was rebuffed, and the next day Tukoji Rao came back to them and said, "I want to take Mumtaz for a movie." So, Shankar Rao Gavde, my man, I mean, he was at that point of time considered to be Tukoji Rao's major donor. So, he will bring her to me, I will take her to the movie, and then she'll be brought back. But instead of taking her to a movie, Tukoji Rao apparently sent Mumtaz Begum to Indore without her mother's consent. So, at that point of time, Wazir Begum had lodged a complaint with the Mumbai police. But I mean, this could not be taken to the logical because there was no documentary evidence at that point of time of Mumtaz Begum being a minor. So, after that, she was kept away from her mother. Her mother, in the meanwhile, married another man called her stepfather was a former soldier and a race hunter. And when Mumtaz was pregnant, she insisted that her mother be allowed to stay with her, at which point of time Wazir Begum and his husband were allowed to shift to Indore. So the Bombay police knew about Mumtaz Begum's association with Indore. In fact, one reason behind Wazir Begum and Mumtaz deciding to shift to Mumbai from Amritsar was that they wanted to seek legal help here, and also because the Mumbai police knew their history. So Mumtaz Begum is a very intriguing woman in this whole saga. She's a sort of, I mean, she's an enigma in that sense, because she was the one who catalyzed this whole episode.
So, you know, I'm going to add one more filmy twist in this, because when I was going through some documents, when I was researching Holkar history in the National Archives of India, I mean, there was speculation, and in the court trial, and there were statements given that Maharaja Tukoji Rao's younger wife, Indravati Bai, or Indira Bai, as she called, she may have been the mastermind of this attempted murder on Mumtaz Begum, so that, you know, it is like killing the two birds with one stone, where she finishes off her rival and frames her husband and becomes kind of a regent of Indore and gets some privileges. So did you come across any reference or any thing on the wives of Indore Maharaja?
In the course of my research, I discovered that Tukoji Rao was not on very friendly terms or amicable terms with his first wife, Chandravati Bai. But they were estranged. And even after the murder, before and after Tukoji Rao's abdication, flurry of letters between the representatives of the crown and Chandravati Bai's partisans, I mean, making all sorts of allegations, saying that they even claimed that Chandravati Bai was dead against Tukoji Rao, taking a mistress, etc. So, well, I mean, I think he was estranged from his first wife. I mean, this is a very interesting angle about Indira Bai.
Yeah, and one more interesting angle, which, you know, even I realized was I have a suspicion. I mean, I'm trying to find a link. That Shankar Rao Gowde was the brother of Chandravati Bai, because she was also a Gowde, and there appears to be some very strong connection between this very devious man who was handling him, doing his dirty work in Bombay, and his wife. So there might have been much more than what meets the eye. But, you know, coming to another very interesting factor, and that is, you see, Holkars, now they belong to the Dhangar community, and Maharaja Tukoji Rao and his father, Maharaja Shivaji Rao, were also involved in social reform movements of the time and kind of a thing. So if you can tell us about this caste and social reform subtext to this crime story?
See, the royal house of the Holkers was founded by Mallara Holkar, who was an extraordinary general. In fact, the emergence of the Marathas as a very strong martial force in North India owes a lot to him and Ranoji Shinde, the founder of the House of the Sindhias. Mallara Holkar hailed from the Dhungar community, which is actually a pastoralist community. They have very significant numbers in Maharashtra. So, in terms of actual numbers, they may be number two after the Maratha Kumbhikar caste system. So, his daughter-in-law, Vidya Devi Holkar, was a very benevolent ruler. In fact, she was the one who renovated the Kashi Vishveshwar temple. She built a lot of arts at Kashi, did a lot of philanthropic work, etc. So, she was a benevolent ruler. Shivaji Rao Holkar, incidentally, there's one common thread that runs through the lives of both Shivaji Rao Holkar and Tukoji Rao. Both of them had to abdicate, but in different sets of circumstances. Because Shivaji Rao Holkar was known for his philanthropy, but he was said to be a man who was prone to extreme fits of anger. And physically, I mean, even if you look at his photograph, you realize that he was a physically very imposing and powerful man. You know, apart from having some anger management problem, so to say, in modern day terminology, was also said to be slightly eccentric. So these fits of anger apparently gave the British a reason to sort of depose him, or force him to abdicate. Tukoji Rao, of course, had to abdicate in a completely different set of circumstances, but both of them, I mean, they supported social reform movements. In fact, Ahilya Ashram in Indore was started by the Holkars. They supported Balgandharva, I mean, the iconic Marathi drama. They supported Marathi writers, poets, etc. You know, a lot of philanthropic activity. In fact, Gopal Ganesh Agarkar and Lokmanya Tilak, when they decided to launch the Deccan Education Society, they got a lot of help from Shivaji Rao Holkar. In fact, the Holkars gave the Wada, that's an old Maratha style in Pune, to the Deccan Education Society to start its institutions. So they did a lot of philanthropy.
So, you know, one very interesting thing is that after the murder, there is this huge wave of outrage, media trial, sensationalism, and then, you know, there is a lot of articles in the nationalistic press about against the decadent and debauched Maharajas and all. Very interestingly, in your book, you write about how the man who took a stand in favor of the Maharaja was none other than Prabodhankar Thackeray, the father of Balasaheb Thackeray and the grandfather of Uddhav Thackeray. So that is one of the most fascinating things in your book. So can you just tell us the role of Prabodhankar Thackeray in this whole saga?
Prabodhankar Thackeray was one of the leading social reformers of Maharashtra, and one of the, I would say, principal figures of the non-Brahmin movement in the state. In fact, let me sort of, you know, make a slight digression here and tell you that just like Lokmanya Tilak started the public celebration of Ganesh Utsav in 1894 or so, it was Prabodhankar Thackeray who took the initiative to launch public celebration of Navratri in Maharashtra as a counter to the Brahmin-dominated or Brahminical celebration of Ganesh Utsav. So the Navratri celebrations that you see, public celebrations of Navratri that you see in Maharashtra today, were actually started by Prabodhankar Thackeray. We talk of Garvaksi, etc., but it was Prabodhankar Thackeray and one of his associates, Sadhu Gajanandra Vaidya, who had started the Hindu Missionary Society to reconvert converted Hindus and also people from other Semitic faiths to Hinduism. So he, I would say, played a seminal role in the development of subaltern Hindutva in Maharashtra. Something that the Shiv Sena, I would say, later carried it forward. In fact, the whole Marathi versus non-Marathi struggle was started by Prabodhankar. It was in 1922. He wrote a series of pieces in his journal, in the periodical Prabodhan, because that is how he came to be called Prabodhankar, because he edited a journal called Prabodhan, about how economic migrants from the southern states were depriving Maharashtrians of employment opportunities, or, you know, sort of depressing the labor market in terms of wages, etc. So Prabodhankar Thakre has played a major role in the development of a larger non-Brahmin counterculture in Maharashtra. So when this whole controversy around the Bawda murder case started, Tukoji Rao Holkar was subjected to what Prabodhankar means as a media trial. So the fact that the press was dominated by the upper caste and the Brahmin community, Prabodhankar felt that sort of tilted the balance against Tukoji Rao, who was a non-Brahmin, as someone belonging to the Dhangar community. So Prabodhankar Thakre wrote 3 books on this issue. 2 were in Marathi, Mahamahayache Thaiman. The second was called Bawla Mumtaz Prakaran, and he wrote a book in English called The Temptress. So in his autobiography, Maji Jeevan Gatha, Prabodhankar dedicates around 3.5 pages to this whole Bawla Mumtaz affair. So he says that the this was so biased against Tukoji Rao that the non-Brahmin or the movement felt slightly stifled, they felt slightly embarrassed at this. So Prabodhankar took a very strong stance in favor of Tukoji Rao Holkar, and he says that copies of his English book were even distributed in the Parliament at London, in the House of Lords. So Prabodhankar Thakre's logic was that 9 people were eventually arrested for the crime, of which 3 were sentenced to death. The main accused in the case was Major General Anand Rao Phansi of the Indore State Army. So Prabodhankar's logic was, presuming that Tukoji Rao Holkar was the principal wire puller in this case, I mean, why is it so that none of those who have been convicted for the crime have named him, even when they face a very certain death? So he took a very strong stance in favor of Tukoji Rao. He went to the extent of accusing Mumtaz Begum of being a pleasure seeker, of a gold digger, and so on and so forth. Eventually, of course, Tukoji Rao had to abdicate, but there were 2 social reformers from Maharashtra who took a very strong stance in his favor. One, of course, was Prabodhankar, and the second was Maharshi Vitthal Ramji Shinde, who held some conferences, etc., to drum up support for him.
So that is fascinating. But even more interestingly, now you in the same camp as Maharaja Tukoji Rao Holkar and Prabodhankar Thakre and Maharshi Shinde is the man who would become the founder of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, where we see him become a defense lawyer for a party of a Hindu Hindu Maharaja's men against a Muslim murdered Muslim Bombay industrialist and his Muslim lover or wife or whatever you call her. So tell us about the role of Muhammad Ali Jinnah in this whole saga.
Jinnah was the defense lawyer for Major General Anand Rao Phansi, who was a crime accused in the case. In fact, Jinnah's wife, T, would make it a point to visit the court almost every day. Contemporary newspapers, etc., say that the courts were actually overflowing with people. Because this was a trial that had captured the attention of the people. So you find several references wherein the accused were taken to court. There was a huge crowd of onlookers who wanted to see them, etc. So sometimes the police would produce them in another court before their remand got over, etc., just to dodge the crowds. Even when 2 of the accused were hung, that is Shafi Ahmad and Captain Shamrao Dighe in the Indore State Air Force, there would be rumors that the 2 of them would be hung. And there would be huge crowds outside the Dongri Jail, which is where the home for juvenile delinquents is located. Children with conflict in top is located at Dongri today. So Jinnah managed to get of course, Anand Rao Phansi was convicted for the crime, but Jinnah managed to using his brilliance as a lawyer, he ensured that his sentence, instead of being executed, he was sentenced to a lifetime of transportation.
How do you see the impact of this case on, say, the Mumbai police or generally crime reporting or generally? What makes this case such a landmark case and what is its legacy?
In fact, today, the Mumbai police is in a bit of a controversy. Sachin Vase case, etc. I must mention the role played by the then Mumbai Commissioner of Police, Sir Patrick Kelly, in cracking the case. Kelly was one of the longest serving police commissioners of Mumbai, around 12 years or so in the police commissioner's chair. He was an Irishman, but he spoke very fluent Marathi with the constabulary. So that, I mean, and again, he was a very upright officer, so he carried a lot of respect in his men. So it is said, I mean, Rohidas Bussar claims in his book that he writes in his book that Sir Patrick Kelly was under intense pressure from the powers that be to go soft on the Indore angle. Perhaps because the British did not want to rock the boat. Indore, as you know, was one of the foremost princely states in India. So that is why maybe they wanted the Mumbai police to go soft on it. So Kelly realized that these pressures were affecting the investigating team. So he actually stood up to his bosses and he said that if you pressurize me or my officers, I will quit. So Patrick Kelly is one man who comes across as a very stern and upright officer in this whole saga. Because he actually stood up to his bosses, put his foot down. He said, no, there's no way I'm going soft on anyone. I mean, the law will take its own course. But I guess, unfortunately, they don't make men like that anymore today.
No, I'm sure. I mean, thank you so much for sharing such interesting perspectives. And I'm sure our viewers will also enjoy reading your book. Thank you so much, Dhaval, for taking time and speaking to us.
My pleasure.
Thanks.